We are so glad to see you one of you this morning. If you are visiting with us today, usually we have a gift just as we come in the morning, but today as well, we have much fruit. So if you're visiting, happy to visit, we would invite you to watch in the live stream. To have the gift of this gift, and I would love to see you in the chicken and the meat. And then what is it? Thank you so much with me. A few announcements. We are still looking for help in children's ministry, which may be the case for some reasons we're trying to help. So if you you're going to help there, you're willing to go through the training process to help us on our team, that would be fantastic. Let me know how to help you. We really appreciate that. And we're happy as well, we have our latest Bible studies on the back end. So this Tuesday, I just mentioned the lunch that's after the service today in the last day. And then finally, something really exciting is that we are going to have a parenting conference. So if you are in camp, as children of the youth, you're in camp. So all of you, this is for you, parenting conference. We have breakout sessions for each age group, all the way up to the adult children. And it's going to take right up to great Saturday to get the learning parenting supporting one another. So if you have February, February 26th, you'll see more information coming out as we get closer. All right, let's go ahead and continue in worship. Father, we can call our Father, we pray to you. You are the one who all things. Father, we trust you for the gift of a new life and a sent word. We pray for healing for those who need it. We pray for comfort for those who are hurting for you. And Father, we pray that you would reveal yourself to all souls, to God. Father, reveal that your business is your business. That's what you do. Thank you for the ministry. Father, we please with our worship. We give it all to you. We offer ourselves as a living sacrifice. Which is just me. Ready for another day of Christ and James here. All right. We're going to invite Matt Worley to come on down. Matt Worley, come on down. Get Matt here. If nothing else, clap because it's Matt, not here. Matt, you're going to make him decide. And John can ask if you'll come on here. If you're the next contestant. anything else to help?
All right, thank you. That's another point. Get them out of here.
That's great.
So you guys are on this. Now we're going to step out of the truth. We're going to listen to a song that we might just find out.
Good job. So that's his point. As you can see, I already had your support.
Okay. All right, now, this next song is probably the most appropriate song.
He's got it. It was fine. All right.
You know, I think I don't know.
I think you can do it.
We'll just do it.
Now you're up to 6 points. The next one is 4 points. And you get this one, you have 5 points. Okay. So let's do that. You had even all the things.
In the first John chapter 2, verses 3 to 11, is where we're at today. In the title of the song, Messages to the Blood of the Holy It's not very many people that I know that just really enjoy this thing. That is especially true for a young man who thought it was a custom joy. The young custom was studied the subject Justin Jordan had his final exam and he was shot. When he stepped down to take that test, he found that the test was nothing more than 25 pictures. He had these pictures that they described as what was the worst. And so Justin said, "You're prepared for this test to be a good one." He marched up to the front of the classroom and said to his professor, "I'm not going to do this. I don't think there's anybody that can pass this test." Professor said, "Fine, then I'll pass it." Well, Justin was angry. He said, "You're able to pass it." So the professor said, "Well, what's your name yesterday?" Without taking a physical test, he took off his feet and said, "It's been 15 years."
this morning, we're going to see the text of Scripture. And the text is related to the point of God. This text is one that I didn't want to show up. Strangely enough, it's kind of about the people of God. We don't want to pull out our feet this morning. It's not about what our family looks like, but when we have our feet, whether we have the contentment of this, or even if we have just the same thoughts, but this morning, what we are going to focus on is the fact that this deals with the world. It deals with the world of promise, a heart to the Christian church. I want to make one thing that's crystal clear that you can't deal with the doubt. There is not one of us that's about to stand. All that stands upon the truth of the Word of God is not one of us that will ever be sinless perfection. So if you hear that right now, if we get ahead of the 1 John chapter 5, verse 13, we sort of get a snapshot of what this book of this book is about and why John was written. It says here, I bring these things to you who believe in the name of the Son of God, so that you may know that you have eternal life. And so that is the strategy that you have. And so with that in mind, when we look at chapter 2, when we pick up this morning in verse 3, we find that phrase. This is how we get present friends. It's going to be used twice this morning in order to see what the rest of the book is. So if you found your way there, 1 John will be in this morning as we look at God's word and read it together. This is how we know that we know Him. If we keep His commandments. The one who says, I have come to know you, and yet doesn't keep his commandments, is a liar, and the truth is not in him. Whoever keeps his word strictly in hand, the love of God is made complete. This is how we know we are in him. The one who says, he remains in him, should walk just as we walk. Dear friends, I have not rise for you to the old commandment that you had from the beginning. The old commandment is the word of the person. Yet I am writing a new commandment which is truly in you, because the darkness is passing away, and its true light is already shining. When he says he is in the light, that he is his brother or his sister, because of the darkness is away. The one who loves his brother or sister remains in the light, and there is no cause for stumbling in him. But the one who hates his brother or sister in the darkness, walks in the darkness, and doesn't know where he's going, because the darkness has blinded him with his eyes. So as God opens this section of Scripture, we see, first of all, this is how we know that we know him. The first thing we see is that we know him as we see him. God opens this section with, by answering the question, how can we know that we see what we've got? Christmas, this gift is how we know. We can also be translated now by this window. So, either way, it's different translation into a new thought, a foolish belief. That we talked about last week, God is the light. So, this morning, John is addressing how can we know that we know the God who is the light. This is how we understand if we keep his commandments. For the Christian, God gives his word. We have a body revelation. He gives his word. But he also does something else. He writes his laws upon our hearts. He writes his laws upon our hearts and changes our hearts. For he informs us by writing his laws upon our hearts. And the understanding is, his law is upon our hearts. It's consistent with the word of God. To be clear, keeping his commandments and your commandments, keeping his commandments is not a prerequisite to be saved. That's if it were even possible. You don't do this, and then because you did good work, you kept his commandments. Now, you're saying, on the other hand, when we get saved, when we come to Christ, God writes our laws on our hearts to begin It's the difference between just saying, it's a word that you carefully treasure. Because if you treasure something, you value it. You know, Pastor Justin hasn't gotten it yet, but I imagine we could sit down with a trophy for his podcast conference. He would probably be grateful for it. He would put it in a prominent place where it gets a thing by all. Spirit. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. This is your captain speaking. We will be crossing the Atlantic this evening at an altitude of 37,000 feet. Our estimated speed is 730 miles per hour. We should reach London in approximately 5 hours. We will take all the systems as I get up. How do you want to get up? It doesn't give us very much confidence when we have to cast it into that flight plan. It's practically a flight plan. But when it comes to be captured with Tesla's ship, when it comes to God, has he not proven himself? He has trusted himself to be trustworthy. And when we're trusted, not only are we saved to trust him, but also we are to live by faith. As we trust him, as we follow him, what happens? You know what? I have confidence when I come to understand this, but over time, following Jesus gives me more confidence. And I'm growing in my confidence in him. My faith is growing stronger. And not only that, my confidence, but his joy is stronger. You see, there's a command that talks about your true nature. The love of God is made complete. Our love of God reigns and improves in perfection when we abide. And the net result of growing our love for God, listen, means that we also grow in our love for one another. Remember when Jesus was asked by the Father, with the first prophet, what is the greatest commandment? And what did Jesus say? He said, love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind. That this is the first and the greatest commandment. And the second is like it. Love. Love God and love others. It comes together and happens. The seven things are love for God and love for others. Listen, nothing is to be greater than our love for God. But our love for God is not going to be great if we are not the one that is true. If we're not the love of our brothers and sisters. Faithfulness to her does not make us mad. Faithfulness to her reveals weakness. We don't do it. And in the same way, obedience to God's commands is the test of our confidence. It is a test of our confidence. This is how we do it. We need to think in this way. We have this is how we know that we can do this. We should walk this path of walk. The 21st verse really is an indispensable work of the Holy Spirit. Do we walk like Jesus walked when he's here with me? What could we mean? What could we mean? What it does mean is that Christ is in us, and he is transforming us in our walk to the end of the world. Big and weak, since this book is in the
Why
lies of truth, because the darkness is passing away. That's a good place to say, hearing. The darkness is passing away. The true light is already shining. Let me walk you through what we talked about. God is light. There is absolutely no darkness in you. Jesus is the light of the world. Jesus is the world. Light is darkness. Jesus for salvation. He transfers us from the domain of darkness into his kingdom. And now Jesus says, church, you are the light of the world. The city that is set on a hill cannot be hidden. We are in Christ. Therefore, the world is meant to see Christ. Verse 19. The one who says he is in the light, but says he hates his brother, sister, and darkness, is the light. In other words, you can just bring your light. You're the light of the world. If you're running around hating your brother, sister, that doesn't mean you're not like God, does it? But yes, you're light. Darkness. And so it's incompatible with our new nature in Christ. For the child of God to continue living with hatred to his or her heart towards brothers and sisters in Christ instead of loving them. Frankly, when we do that, we get love, what? We live in a world that is easy to do so very publicly. It's so easy to go through social media posts. Twisting the truth, taking things out of context, blatantly mischaracterizing, disappointing the truth of others. It's much too much of those who can't remember Jesus. Some may ask me, what if a brother or sister in Christ is in the wrong? And I'm just merely calling them out. Well, the Bible tells us how to do that. Such is not consistent with Scripture. It's not edifying to the body of Christ. It's not a good witness to the watch that's working. The world will not come to know that Christ, because it sees us doing such a good job of correcting them. The world will not come to know Christ, because it says, boy, look at the fact that they will not fight the good fight. But if you will come to know Christ, we will experience the love of Christ and Christ, particularly for us, one another. The non-believer who acts this way is just acting in a manner consistent with his nature, his ways, his dead, his transgressions, and his plans. But the believer also can act out of the flesh with what he knows and there. Here's the thing for believers. Yes, we're still together. Yes, there are things that we don't think that we regret But then it becomes the convicting process of the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is the convicting of the Holy Spirit of the Holy Spirit. We can't just think of this as well. If there is something like a cancer, if you are not guilty of treating it very easily, then it's almost like or that I do that, the farther I'm getting away from his voice, and before you know it, the voice is beginning to say, and maybe you can think of it. I can, that's why it's so important to get to the Lord. Why is it that it's a dead voice? I think it's a creature that gets away. It's the reason to get this way. Disbelieving Christ, but also practically walking with him.
I
if you are a guest, if this is your first time with us, please drop us a suggestion for us to be back at this table. And yes, again, for your also, we have a march today. So, for those who are here for the first time, or who recently get studied at this for the last several weeks or months, and you have a chance to get one of these launches, this opportunity to ask just to know more about it. Thank you.